Yogi is saying, if we grow, if the plot area is more than 4,000 square meter and abutting road of 18 meter and above, the FSI will be one additional. That additional FSI is being shared between MADA and the developer at the ratio of 2:1. That is 0.67 to MADA and 0.33 to the developer. Earlier, this entire one was to be given to MADA at construction cost. One more is the MADA share can be given in the same ward somewhere else, but it will be indexed to the ready reckoner rate. Earlier, the consents were 70%. Now they have been brought down to 51%. Slums in MADA colonies, most of the MADA colonies, a small portion of a MADA colony is invariably you will find slums. There are few MADA colonies where there are no slums. So what was happening is all those slum areas were excluded in the layout and they were left to SRA to develop. Now it can be developed under 33.5, subject to 25% upper cap for the slum. Convenience shopping earlier was allowed for roads of 12 meter and above. Now it can be allowed for 9 to 18 meters. Earlier there was a saving clause that if there was a valid offer letter or NOC, you could proceed with the earlier regulation. So most of the valid offer letters or NOCs were by paying premium. So we could continue by paying premium by flashing the old offer letter NOC till the end of the project. Now that has been removed. So what will happen to those projects which are running, ongoing, which have got offer letters or NOC by paying premium is something that needs to be pondered upon. 33.6 is the redevelopment of dilapidated buildings. Existing built-up area is protected. Here, the funny part is, if a building has been declared as dilapidated, dangerous, and the owner is served upon a notice to pull it down, owner has got no go but to pull it down. If the owner pulls it down, doesn't get the benefit of 33.6. Only if the building collapses or if it is gutted by fire, then only the benefit of 33.6. Not otherwise. This is the wording. I think we all will have to file suggestion objections to that effect to see that this doesn't happen, because if the owner has been given a notice under, because the wording is if owner voluntarily demolishes the building. So if the owner gets a notice, he has to demolish. There is no other way. If the existing built-up area, if you choose to use only existing built-up area, then the premium for the fungible built-up area is 6.25%. of RR rate, otherwise it's a regular premium even for deficiency in open space. 33.10 is the regulation, I believe, which has got maximum number of EPs. It has got 11 EPs. So I think the trophy for maximum EPs should go to 33.10. Rehab carpet area has been pegged at 25 square meters inclusive of FC built-up area, the fungible compensatory built-up area, and this is not an EP. We have government which has declared that the intention of the government is to give 30 square meter carpet rehab houses to the slum dwellers. Now with this capped, I don't know how that promise can be fulfilled. Earlier there was a provision wherein SRA could declare certain areas as difficult areas. So all 3.11 schemes were declared as difficult areas and they were enjoying the benefit of 1:1.33. So if you construct 1 square meter, we used to get 1.33 square meter as TDR. Now that cannot be done. The premium to be paid for government land or MADA land was pegged at 25%. But there was a bit of a confusion there, because the premium was allowed to be paid in three stages. So many a times, when you go to the next stage, the ready reckoner rate has increased, so additional premium was being charged. Now it is made very specifically clear in the regulation that the premium has to be paid on the day of first payment, that is on the day of LOI, on the day of approval. Now, most of these slum schemes, we are not able to propose in-situ transit camp. So, rents are being paid to the slum dwellers. For eviction of the slum dwellers, 33 and 33A of Slum Act have been enacted, section 33, 33A and 38. But the regulation said that for non-cooperating slum dwellers, you can give him various modes of notices. So, there was a bit of a dichotomy between what is the provision of Slum Act and what is the provision of DC regulation. Now, that has been rectified. Additional incentive for aggregation of slum. If somebody is doing a larger slum pocket, then additional incentive is being granted, which is a very welcome step. So basically, rather than fragmented slum schemes being happening, now there will be aggregation of slum schemes and larger slum schemes will happen. So there are somebody goes above 16 hectares, the additional is 20%. The minimum tenement density has been increased to 650. Earlier it was 500, now it has been increased to 650. In cases where there are constraints, the CEO SRA has been empowered to condone 25%, so it comes down to 487.5. There is no higher cap now for a slum scheme. Earlier there was a cap of 3 if the tenement density was less than 650, and 4 if the tenement density was above 4. Now you have to consume 4. It is like 33.7. Where 4 has to be consumed, but there is no upper cap. Rehab plus incentive is your upper cap. So there is no upper cap there. Open space, I am only highlighting the things which are changing, which are changed from what is being practiced. I am not going through the entire regulation because then it will take a long time. Open space along the nala can be 3 meters provided the other bank of nala, somebody has provided 6 meters. So if we have a slum and other bank of nala is non-slum, they are forced to provide 6 meter open spaces, then we are lucky. If there are slums on either side of the nala, one who develops floods is hit. Minimum margin in open space has been increased from 1.5 meters to 3 meters. At the same time, the low rise definition has increased from 24 meters to 32 meters. But the minimum marginal open space of 3 meters, so there was a hue and cry about the slum schemes having lesser marginal open spaces. I think that will be addressed to some extent. It will definitely add to our woes to plan a building, but the slum dwellers' concerns will be addressed. For joint development of slum and non-slum, earlier there was no upper cap. So it was rather than eating chutney with the idli, many a times it so happened that you ate only chutney and no idli. So slums were only a small minuscule part of a larger development. But because there was slum, except 339, because there was slum, we were forced to go to SRA and get the entire development approved. Now, if we want to do a joint development between slum and non-slum, there is a cap. So slum has to be 75% and only 25% non-slum. Infrastructure charges which were flat at 560 in suburbs and 840 in city, now are pegged at redirection rate 2%, so there will be an increase in most of the cases. Amenities. Earlier there were 3 amenities that we have to provide, slum, welfare center, society office and Balwadi, 1 for every 100 or part thereof. Now it is 4 amenities per 250 or part thereof. Welfare center and Balwadi is compulsory, and then there is a list of 6 amenities, you have to provide any 2 of them. So 4 amenities per 250 and society office 1 per 100. So if we take 500 slums, actually the number of amenities have decreased from 15 to 13. So there is a decrease in common amenities. Earlier there was a bit of a non-clarity on how much reservations have to be provided in slums. It was 15% of the reservation area, or 25% of the reservation area, or 50% of the plot area for those reservations for which guidelines have not been approved by the government. That means if there was a market reservation in slum, we have to provide 40% built-up area on 50% built-up area on 40% land. But now that has been removed, it's flat. Any reservation, any buildable reservation, any slum, we have to provide 25% of the built-up area. And for non-buildable reservation, earlier it was 33% and 66% to be handed over as reservation and 33% to be made buildable. Now 33% is made buildable, 35% has been made buildable and 65% to be left open. So there is a decrease there. In case of school reservations which have spread across various slums, there are many such reservations in slums wherein you don't get the entire reservation under one particular slum scheme. So it so happened that in that case, every small portion of the school reservation had to provide 500 or 800. 500 for primary, 800 for secondary. So that reservation, so it led to multiplicity of reservations being provided. Now it is pro rata. So this is one more good change that has happened. Clubbing, unfortunately the wording of clubbing has been, there is a cut and paste job between 3310 and 3311. That is PTC schemes. So the entire wording of 3311 you will find in 3310. So it is not getting us to very clear as to what we have to do for clubbing of two slum schemes. But what I can deduce from whatever is there is two schemes by two different developers can be clubbed. Two or more schemes from different developers can be clubbed. Two or more schemes having different ownerships can be clubbed. Now earlier clubbing was allowed without any premium. Now premium of 40% is attached. Actually this is counterproductive to the slum schemes. There are certain areas in Mumbai where slum scheme is absolutely non-viable because the rates are so low. So the slums in lakes, say for example Kurar, no slum in Kurar is getting developed. Now what people were doing is they were clubbing say Kurar with say Juhu or with Bandra and making it viable by shifting few people from Bandra to Kurar by mutual understanding. And the schemes at Kurar were happening, schemes at Bandra are at better locations were happening. Now with this premium to be paid, no schemes in those areas would happen. Clubbing has to be within 5 kilometer radius. Limitation. So this suggestion of everybody, all of us will have to file that this cut and paste job between 33.11 and 33.10, that there has to be a bit of better clarity about clubbing in 33.10. 3.11 schemes are majorly affected now. Number one, they are indexed. The slum TDR is indexed. 1.33 additional that we were getting has been scrapped. The construction TDR has been indexed to the construction cost, as was happening for the buildable amenities. And the land is again, as per the any other land, twice in suburbs and 2.5 times in city. So the quantum of TDR generated from a 3.11 scheme would drastically alter. Ongoing 3.11 schemes with 20.9 carpet area can be converted to 25 square meter and claim the benefit of FSI 4. There are two contradictory provisions in this regulation. What happens if I have got the existing LOI and there is a reservation in my slum? And because the scheme was not viable, slum dwellers have filed suggestion objections. The planning committee has accepted the suggestion objection. Corporation has accepted the suggestion objection and removed the reservation. But I have an LOI which is valid and subsisting, and I want to continue with the same LOI. Then at one place at DCR 17.3D it says that you all the provisions of 1991 will apply. And in 33.10.8.1 it says the entire same wording has been copied, but it has been deleted with black lines. What Sukhatme said earlier, Ranga Panchami, at one place it is in pink color, at another place it has been cut with black color. Now which will prevail? Actually, logically, if there is no provision in DCR 2034 and my LOI is subsisting but the reservation has not been implemented, we should be allowed to go by 2034 at the choice of the developer. But that is not the case here. Schemes can be converted to new regulations only if the LOI is amended. So what I have to do, I have to amend maybe 0.1 square meter of my rehab built up area and say my scheme is amended, and then I can come up with a new regulation. Why this play off? Why we are being made to play? I appeal to everyone to file a suggestion objection to that effect. Please not make us play such games. Let us be open. If I come as per the new regulation, I should be allowed to, in toto, I should be allowed the new regulation. Just because I have an LOI and I don't want to amend it, I will go by the old regulation. This is something which needs to change. When we go to Dharavi, there are very few changes in Dharavi. In fact, there is only one, there are two EPs under Dharavi. There's a new definition of implementing sector. Earlier there was those planning sectors. Dharavi was divided into various planning sectors. Now there's a new definition of implementing sector. Probably the government has realized that redeveloping the Dharavi the way it is been planned with the six sectors, it will not work. Probably it will have to be broken down into smaller subsectors. That's why this definition has come in. Earlier there was no premium for redevelopment of MADA government land under DRP. There was no premium because government was thinking of inviting tenders. If I fill up a tender and provide and promise X premium to the government, charging premium over and above was not there. Probably now government is thinking of allowing redevelopment of Dharavi into smaller parts, smaller chunks, and again the earlier way, whosoever comes forward will be allowed to develop. That's why this provision seems to have come. Deemed NOC clause, one more change which I in fact glossed over. 2.10 clause in under 33.10 said that for a government land, after LOI is granted, within 30 days, if NOC is not granted, it is deemed to be granted. So it was actually a facilitation measure for slums on government land. Now it is said NOC is deemed to be granted only if it is not rejected by the government giving specific reasons. So that means the moment LOI is communicated to the land zoning authority, one line later will come: due to reasons which government thinks fit and will be communicated later, slum scheme should not be allowed. How will the slum schemes on government, municipal, MADA land happen otherwise? Same clause has come in 33.10A also. Here there are 7 common amenities that have to be provided for every 100. So it's not like 33.10 where there are lesser amenities to be provided. In fact, the amenities have increased from 3 to 7. This number has been corrected thankfully while the gazette was notified. There was this 250 number printed 96 times. What we got on 8th of May, we all have studied. So that has been luckily changed in the gazette which has come in. There are minor changes in the reservations. Rejigging of reservations have happened. Dharavi is Mime Nature Park. There was a hue and cry that it was called as a recreational ground. Now it is being called as a Mime Nature Park. There is again a sea change in 33.11 schemes, which we used to call as 33.14 schemes earlier. FSI is again linked to road width and the plot area both. So plots less than 2000 or abutting roads less than 12 meters will get FSI 3. Plots having area more than 4000, more than 2000 and abutting 18 meter and more will get FSI 4. What happens to a plot which is between? Plot area of 3000 but abutting road width of 12 meters or 13 meters. So that is not clear because it is not either or, it is and. The table is, has been drafted in a way that it is and. So that is an ambiguity that we need to address. 25% of the basic FSI has to be used for shop. It is, the word is shall, not may. Again, if somebody doesn't want to do shopping, this compulsion of doing shopping is something which is inexplicable. If you create housing stock, it should be better. Again, the clubbing by two different developers, two different schemes is allowed. Even base FSI can be clubbed. Today, out of 2.5, one was base in suburbs and 1.5 was the additional, which was shared between government and you. And so base was never allowed to be floated. Now even base can be floated. So we will have only PTC buildings coming on one plot and pure sale happening on another plot. There is no sale happening on any one plot. So that is a change. The premium is different. The premium for floating the additional FSI, that the, now the FSI is 4 instead of 3 earlier. Out of 1, say in suburbs, and this is allowed in city also, but in suburbs, say 1 is my zonal, the remaining 3 is to be shared as 1.5, 1.5. If I want to float that 1.5, then the premium is 40% of unearned income, that is the difference in ready reckoner rate minus cost of construction of both rehab and sale, minus the premiums paid to the government. If we actually work out, in most of the cases, it comes out to be negative. So nothing needs to be paid. And if we want to float the base FSI, one FSI also in form of PTC, then the 100% of difference of ready reckoner rate has to be paid. So then we would see change in 3311 schemes, PTC schemes. We foresee many more 3314 schemes coming up in future. 3312A is for contaminant structure in TP scheme. Total FSI is 4, incentive of 50% of rehab, all this is same. Contravening structures can be accommodated in the same scheme or in the same ward. So it's not compulsory that I have to keep them in the same TP scheme. They can be in the same administrative ward also. But there are many schemes which have been sanctioned say in 60s, 70s, 80s. Now some structures have come up on the OP plots which have not been actually handed over or taken over by the corporation. Now even those structures are allowed to be rehabilitated, same as slum. Even commercial tenants not listed in the TP scheme records can be rehabilitated. The fungible compensatory area for the rehab is without charging premium, everything else is by charging premium. Removal of structures falling in the alignment of the road. See, there are many structures, we travel on say LBS, we find structures suddenly jutting out on that LBS road. Now all those structures which otherwise were not developable will be developed under 3312B. Now there are two structures, one is tolerated and protected. Now protected has been added as an EP, but what is protected is not defined. So that is something that needs to be defined. We need to say probably what the government meant was protected is same as in slum. That is 112,000. But that definition is not missing from the entire DCPR. So that has to come in. This is mill worker housing where the component is handed over to MHADA for construction of mill worker housing. So FSI is 4. But there MHADA has to pay premium even for providing premium fungible built-up area for mill worker housing. So probably those 35% lesser houses for mill workers will get constructed. Public parking lot is almost same. Minimum road width has been prescribed now at 80 meters. Minimum 50 vehicles parking or minimum area of 700 square meters and plot area has been reduced drastically to 1000 square meters. This development is allowed as top up. That means you can give base FSI plus government FSI plus TDR and then this can be used as a top up, which is not the case in most of the other developments. And the same developer cannot operate the PPL. So PPL will be probably auctioned by corporation to people for who can operate the PPL. Thank you.